And what I'm going to ask you to do today, I want to start us out with a paradoxical statement. And it's a difficult thing for us to hear. It's something that makes no sense, which is what makes it a paradox. And one of the things, somehow as human beings, and as human beings in the 21st century, there's a lot of thought and perhaps even a lot of obsession over money and over material goods and material wealth. And so here's the paradoxical statement for us. It's a profoundly spiritual statement for us, but it's a difficult thing for us to hear. Sacrifice is a key to enjoyment. Sacrifice is a key to enjoyment. And what the stewardship committee has asked me to do, and I have to confess I'm not completely comfortable with it, but they asked me to tell you my story. And my story of what I call my journey to tithing. And it is about sacrifice and the enjoyment that I have found. Now, as I tell you my story, this is just my story. This is my journey. All of our journeys are different, and the ways that we get there are different. But the way the Holy Spirit moves us and moves in our hearts is the same. And the beauty about the Holy Spirit is God knows what you need, and God knows what I need, and God moves us in the ways that God knows that we need to be moved. So as I tell you my story, it's not because I'm a priest. I would be doing this anyway. I did it before I was priesthood. And B, it's not about how wonderful I am. It's about how the love of Jesus Christ has touched my life and moved me to do what I've chosen to do. And so my journey to tithing began actually with an awareness and an appreciation, a profound understanding and knowledge of the promise of having a relationship with Jesus Christ as my Savior. And this began tragically with the death of my brother shortly before his 17th birthday, and I was 19 at the time. And it was through that terrible tragic event, in the words of my spiritual director, that in God's economy, nothing is wasted, that I came to understand Jesus as my friend, as my comforter, and as my Savior. And the love of God deeply and profoundly touched my heart in that experience. And so what I started to do, it was the summer of my freshman year, what I started to do when I went back to school in September is I started to go back to church. And I was raised in the Episcopal Church. I'm a third generation Episcopalian. And so I went back to the Episcopal Church. And I would sit, and I'd sit in the pew, and a lot of times, at least the first year I was there, I cried pretty much every Sunday. And it was just, I like to think of that as the Holy Spirit cleaning my heart. And it helped me work through my grief, and it helped me also to get back in touch with the vocational calling that I had since I was 10 years old. And as I sat there, and I grew in my understanding of the Episcopal Church and how things worked and my faith in Jesus Christ. I remember clearly one day, it was really a pivotal moment for me. I was walking back to the dorm after I had been in church, and it was a beautiful spring day, and I was sort of skipping down the sidewalk on the way back. I was just in such an elated mood. And for whatever reason, I looked down the sidewalk and I saw the ants. My mother taught us to look for bugs. So I look for bugs a lot. Some I like better than others, but I still look for bugs. And so I noticed the ants. And as I noticed the ants, I was profoundly and deeply aware, not only of how small the ants are in comparison to me, how small I am in comparison to God's great universe. And that despite how minute I am in the greater scheme of creation, that I mattered enough to the God of all creation that We do have an access to people about these things as jokes. And we fell in love as couples do, and we got married, and he was in the Navy, and he was an ensign in the Navy, and as an ensign in the Navy, he earned $9,000 a year. And we thought that was a lot. And so off we go to Norfolk, Virginia, and first we were in Pensacola, Florida. We were in Pensacola, Florida for training, and we were going to Christ Church in Pensacola, Florida, and it was the time in a sort of historically, almost all the churches were doing this at the time. They were doing every member canvas, where two members of the church would come to visit you as a parishioner and bring the annual pledge card and talk to you about the needs of the church and then ask you to sign the pledge card, which is what they did. And so we're sitting there having this conversation with them, and my husband and I talked about it a little bit, and I said, well, we can give $5 a week. We can give $20 a month, because that's all we can afford. And the woman said, oh, okay, are you sure you could maybe give a little bit more than that? I said, no, really, this is all we can afford. And so we gave $5 a month. And we did that, $5 a week. And we did that for quite a while. And then we moved to Norfolk, Virginia. And in the time we moved to Norfolk, it was always a matter, what we gave to the church was always a matter of what we could afford. And we were giving money to the church. And that's an important thing to hold on to for them. So we moved to Norfolk, and we get there with an amazing preacher. And suddenly, something started to happen to my heart. And I don't know what, and I can't describe what it is, but something started to happen to my heart. Whereas as he would preach, and it was annual giving time, and he would preach about tithing, he actually had the courage to use the T word in church. Because tithe, the first 10%, of all that we have and all that we are, that's all God asks of us, is the first 10%. He leaves us the other 90% all to our own devices, whatever we want to do with it. But the biblical standard is the top, giving the first 10%. And he would preach about this. But he would preach about it in a grace-filled way, not a guilty way, not a way to make us feel like if we didn't do it, something terrible was going to happen, or we were bad Christians if we didn't. And that is all true. It's true. Because what I discovered in my journey is that the decision to tithe is a decision of the heart. It's not an intellectual decision. Because if we were all intellectual about how we tithe, we would never do it. But tithing is a decision of the heart. And so what I began to discover in this journey was my heart began to open in a different kind of way, and all of a sudden, I wanted to tithe. Because instead of giving to the church, what I wanted to do was to give just a little bit, back to God for all that God did and does for me. And it's the words of our hymn today, our opening hymn, today. Thank you, John. So let the love of Jesus come and set thy soul ablaze. To give and give and give again what God hath given thee. To spend thyself nor count the cost. To serve right gloriously the God who gave all worlds that are and all that are to be. That was the shift. That was the change in thinking what I could afford versus I cannot give enough. And how small your 10% is for all that God has given me. And so I worked into the tithe. I gradually worked into it, and I'm happy to say that I have finally accomplished that goal. that spiritual goal of giving the first 10% not only of my money, but of my time and of my talents. Because it's all three. It's not a balance of each. I don't get to do the math on that and add up to 10%. It's 10% of each. 10% of each. But I have to also tell you, honestly, the journey has not always been easy. It's been scary sometimes. There have been times when I really didn't think I could afford to give the tithe. And there are also, honestly, times when I hit some financial bumps in the road where I didn't fulfill the pledge that month. But I always tried to catch it up. Because it was a decision of the heart. It was about giving back to God. It wasn't about feeling guilty. It wasn't about earning the love of God. It wasn't about buying my eternal life insurance policy. It wasn't about any of that. It was about what that hymn speaks of today. And so, you know, somebody once said to me, well, is that gross or is that net income? And the truth of the matter is it doesn't matter. The truth of the matter is it's about our intentions. It's about where our hearts are, and not necessarily where our heads are. Because here's the thing that I've learned. In learning to let go of my material fears, in learning to let go of my financial fears, because trust me, nothing will teach you better than tithing to let go of your financial fears. Because it moves us from a place of scarcity and thinking we might run out, we might not have enough, to an awareness of the abundance that God has given us, that even though I give 10%, I still have more than I could ever imagine or ask for. It's amazing. And what I also discovered is the more I give, the more I seem to have. And I don't know why that is. Is it sacrificial? Yes, it is sacrificial. Are there times I sit and think what could be in my bank account or my investment account? Yes, I do. Because I'm human, and I worry about money. But I'll also tell you that since I made that decision to tithe, I really worry so much less about money. And I can't even say that I gave like the widow did of all that I have. I still give out of my abundance and not out of my poverty. And perhaps I could be moved to give even more. Because that's the thing, is I cannot give enough of all that I am and all that I have to this God who loves me, no matter what, who loves me no matter what. So your journeys may be different. You may find something different for you and where God moves you. But let me first say formally, as the rector of this church, no matter what you do or how much you give, thank you. Thank you for all that you do to make this place the wonderful place it is. Because what I realize and acknowledge and honor is that whatever you give to St. Matthias, it's not your electric bill, it's not your mortgage payment, you don't have